No, he wouldn't stay too. No, he was there. He wanted. He wanted. He wanted more of an excuse.
Hello, baby doll.
We missed you. Oh, nice to see you.
We have broken the wire today. Not that we can sing, but we'll try.
Thank you. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Shed abroad this gift throughout the world by the preaching of the gospel, that it may reach to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
First lesson is from the second chapter of Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each of them heard them speaking in the native tongue of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the the last days it will be, though God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is a portion of Psalm 104, and we will read it responsibly, breaking the asterisks. O Lord, how manifold are your works.
In wisdom and in all, the earth is full of your riches.
Yonder is the great and wide sea, with its living things too many to number.
Creatures small and great.
There are the ships, and there is that Leviathan.
Which you have made for the sport of them.
All of them look to you.
You give them their food in due season.
You give it to them, they gather it.
You open your hand, and they are filled with their goodness.
You hide your face, and they are terrified.
You take away their breath, and they die and return to their house.
You send forth your spirit, and they are created.
And so you renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
May the Lord rejoice in all of his works.
He looks at the earth and it trembles.
He touches the mountains and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live.
I will praise my God while I have my being.
May these works of mine please him.
I will rejoice in the Lord.
The second lesson for today is from 1 Corinthians 12. No one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are a variety of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, and to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All of these are activated by the one and the same Spirit, who allots to each individually just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the one body and has many members, and all members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." This is the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. In the year 2002, I accepted the call to be rector of St. Christopher's in Carmel, Indiana, which meant going to the Midwest where I really had never been before, leaving my native New England. It was kind of an adventure. And my wife had one request. She said to me, "We need to find a house with a basement." And I said, "Yeah, okay." And she said, "Well, they have tornadoes in Indiana, and we need a place where we can shelter." Fine. So we found a house with a basement. And there were several nights that we spent in the basement, although a tornado never came into our neighborhood. It was close by. And what we discovered, though, after we moved in, within about a week, was that the tornado siren was in our backyard. It was very hard to sleep through the night when the siren went off because it was deafening. But the worst thing was, my day off was on Friday. They used to test the tornado siren on Friday at 11. And I'd forget about that, and I'd be out in the backyard, and all of a sudden, oh my goodness, it was deafening. It would go on for a minute or two. In any event, we saw some tornadoes while we were there. None came really close to us, but every time I read the account in the book of Acts of the Pentecost event now, I think about Indiana tornadoes. I mean, look at what Luke has done. He talks about the rush of a mighty wind, and I've got news for you. Tornadoes sound like freight trains. They really do come. The rush of a mighty wind and then tongues of fire infiltrating the room where the disciples were, landing on each of them, giving them this powerful gift of the Spirit. It's worthy of a Hollywood movie. Think about the special effects we have today and what somebody would do with that kind of a scene. I mean, it's really amazing. And the disciples up until this point were pretty much keeping a low profile. I mean, they were still afraid of the Jewish authorities. They were usually secluded and locked away and meeting with each other and not really being very public about the ministry that Jesus had until this happened. This was a transforming event for them. It filled the house. They were empowered. They went out into the public square. Now, Pentecost is the Greek word for the Jewish festival, the Feast of Weeks. Penta meaning 50. The Feast of Weeks would occur in the Jewish calendar 50 days after Passover. And it was a time that pilgrims would come to Jerusalem, just like Passover. And so I have to believe that perhaps this was the first time the disciples were together again in one place since the ascension. And probably they were in the same upper room that they were in, I assume, when they broke bread together at that first Eucharist, and, you know, Passover time. So they're together, and this happens, and now they're out in the public square, and we know, according to Luke, that devout people came from all over Judea who spoke multiple languages, and they were there for the pilgrimage. So the disciples are now speaking in what scholars call glossolalia, speaking in tongues. But actually what it wasn't gibberish. What they were doing was speaking in ancient languages. And they were speaking all the languages that the people who had come for the pilgrimage could understand. So God's message was going out to all people regardless of the language they spoke. Now it was interesting. This empowered them. They're out there and Peter addresses people of Jerusalem and Judea. These men are not drunk as you might think they are. The skeptical people said, oh, they're just filled with new wine. But he said, they're not drunk, it's 9 a.m. That always makes me chuckle a little bit because I had some fraternity brothers in college who were drunk at 9 a.m. frequently. That's not necessarily a good proof text, but here he says, they're not drunk at all, but they are fulfilling the prophecy of the prophet Joel. Joel says in the book at the end of his writings that at the end of the ages, God will fill all people with his spirit and they will do amazing things and they will go out. And so Peter says, no, they're just fulfilling the prophecy of Joel and they're moving out. Now, in the gospel reading from John, we hear a different story of the giving of the spirit, if you will. And I don't necessarily think that it contradicts Luke, because I think the Spirit can be given in many different ways. But in John's Gospel, this is his Pentecost. He talks about them being gathered together on Easter night. And remember, the first time they were together on Easter night, Thomas was not there. Thomas came later. So Jesus comes into this locked, enclosed room where they're cowering for fear of the Jews, as it says. And he says, peace be with you. Peace be with you. And he says, as the Father has sent me, I will send you. And I will give you authority. If you retain the sins of any, they will be retained. But if you forgive people, they will be forgiven. Authority to bind sin or not, to release it. I would venture to say that what Jesus is doing here is he is ordaining these people. It's the same thing as an ordination. What happens to us when people lay hands on our heads and say, receive the Holy Spirit. He breathes on them. It is a very gentle receiving of the Spirit. You know, Luke's is violent and powerful and transformative. And here is just a very gentle breath of Jesus. Receive my Spirit. I ordain you to do my ministry. Go forth into the world. Now, I don't know about you folks, but the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, is very difficult for me to get my arms around. I mean, I understand God the Creator, Jesus the Redeemer. The Spirit is supposed to be the Comforter, the Advocate, the one who reminds us of Jesus' power, the one who gives us courage and power as we minister as disciples of Jesus Christ. But it's very hard. I can't see it. I can't get my arms around it. But I can feel it. Very hard to define, hard to describe, but I know when the Spirit is with me. I can feel that. Now, several years ago, the Supreme Court of the United States was dealing with a First Amendment issue of free speech that had to do with pornography. What is pornography? What should be allowed? What shouldn't be allowed? What's free speech and what is detrimental to the community? And I remember Justice Payne Stewart at the time made a comment that became famous, actually. He basically said, I can't define pornography. I can't describe it. But I know when I see it. And I kind of think the same thing about the Holy Spirit. I can't define it. I can't describe it. I can feel it, and I know it when I feel it. It gives me power and courage to do things I might not normally do in the name of God. So on this Feast of the Holy Spirit, I would say we need to pray for the courage to receive the Spirit and know that when we do, we'll be able to accomplish things that we might not be able to on our own. But we also need to know that if we invite the Spirit into our hearts and into our lives, then we need to be ready for, in some sense, a bumpy ride. The Spirit blows where it wills, and we may be asked to do things that we never thought we could, and that's a little scary. But with God's comforter, God's advocate in our lives, we can do those things. So join me now in praying that we can accomplish those things through the Spirit. Lord, give us the courage to open our hearts to your Holy Spirit. It is the gift you left us with to empower us, to guide us, to comfort us in the journey that we have in ministry. We pray that we will accomplish things in your name that we never could if we only embrace the Spirit. Give us the courage to invite that Spirit in this day and in the year ahead. And we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Please stand if you're able, and let us profess our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people for today are Form 3, as printed in your leaflet. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Thomas, our bishop. For Steve, our supply priest, and Jean, our deacon. And for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in God's church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
I ask your prayers for Norm Anderson, who is in hospice care now.
For Duane.
For all on our St. George's prayer list. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
Beautiful spring.
We will
exalt you, O God, our King, and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom.
We especially pray for Christy McKean, who died this week. We also, on this Memorial Day weekend, pray in thanksgiving for all the people who have died in service to their country, people whose sacrifice, brave and valiant sacrifice, has kept us free and preserved our liberty.
Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Lord, let trust in you.
Let us confess our sins to God. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry that we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace in the back row. Yes, please. Please be seated. Please remember that next Sunday we begin one service in the summer at 9 a.m., so mark your calendar. 9 a.m. instead of 10. Oh, okay. I was wondering about that. Yeah. Okay, so you don't have to get here extra early to get coffee. Just stay for a few minutes after and have some fellowship with everyone. We do have a cleanup of our buildings and grounds this Saturday from 8 until 11. If you're able to come and would like to participate, many hands make the work light, so please feel free to do that. Any other announcements? Okay.
If anybody wants to come and help support the community in general, please feel free to do so.
Since I'm new, where is that? Where does that happen?
It's going to be at Gallon Park. It's from 12 to understand the word.
All right.
And the
men's practice will be the 17th.
17th? Okay.
Yesterday we had our highest number of baby blessings come through the door. We had 9, and that's, I think, due to the fact that Mel has got the advertisement out on Facebook. So what I'm asking for is, seeing as this is an uptick, this is like twice what we normally get. We usually average 4 or 5 each month. If you could be generous and donate. Use the bean pot over here. If you're not comfortable using the bean pot, put it in an envelope, put it in a plate. But that'll help us greatly in the next few months. Thanks.
Are we
baby blessings. This was started by Marie Bean 4 years ago. And she had the thought that the young mothers, or older mothers, I should say, also include also, at the end of the month, sometimes they run a little short on either WIC or whatever their allotment is. So this is, we give them a thing of diapers, a thing of wipes, and if we've got formula, there's formula that they can have if they want. And we give them a $20 gift card for necessities at Hannaford. So that's where all this money goes.
Yes.
March.
Well, this is not church, but it's related because it's about the weekend. It's Memorial Weekend, as we all know. And I don't know how many people understand what the project of the paper poppies is. It's over 100 years. At 1921 it started. I have a little paper out in the parish hall, and it gives us a history, the story of the poppy that veterans make in the hospital, and it's a memoriam to those that have gone. And all the wars, there have always been veterans. Every war we had, and heaven knows what they would be, but this is out in the, if anybody cares to donate, there's a place to put a little change. We don't ask for, and we're not soliciting. So the soliciting means
proselytizing.
Persuasion. We don't persuade anybody.
Not going to twist our arms.
No. We just offer them. I did it at Springvale Hardware Store. Just offer them in memoriam. But it means something. And we've been doing it, as I say, for over 100 years. The American Legion Auxiliary. And I hope you are interested. You ever see anybody with poppies? That's what it's all about. Thank you.
Several years ago, I was a VA chaplain. This was a busy day for me, or a busy weekend. Yeah, we did a lot of wreath laying and stuff. Yeah, we did. Did anybody have a birthday this week? Would you like a blessing? Okay, good.
Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor on this your servant as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen her trust in your goodness all the days of her life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Happy birthday.
Any anniversaries? No? June is a big wedding month, so maybe we'll hit the jackpot next month. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In fulfillment of his true promise, the Holy Spirit came down on this day from heaven, lighting upon the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood, and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Spoken through the prophets, and above all in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death,
we proclaim his resurrection,
we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with blessed George and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. By faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ.